Suddenly, something sharp ripped into the tent, sort of like a spear running down the stiff fabric, tearing through it like a zipper. We all sat up and reeled back in shock, unable to scream in terror. The sharp object pulled back into the darkness and an arm shot inside, dirty and reeking of dried blood. Once the dirty arm had gotten deep enough inside the tent, a face came in after the shoulders. It was so hideous, a sight so frightening that I almost blacked out. I could only glimpse two bright almond-shaped eyes, visible in the dark, against a dark oval which was the creature's head, almost twice as large as my own head. In a frenzied fashion, it searched around the tent as the arm grabbed the journalist by the shirt and pulled her outside effortlessly. Such was its strength. Petrified, I saw her legs leaving the tent, struggling as if she was being hanged. Screams permeated the night as a he hopped outside, rifle ready. I counted about three or four shots, the muzzle flashes lighting up everything outside the tent. Our journalist kept on screaming and struggling before I heard a metallic clatter. Strange as it was already, her screams abruptly stopped. Even Yahim stopped firing his semi-automatic. Scared, desperate but determined, we all rushed outside the tent to help. Our photographer clicked on two of our flashlights and handed one to me as we hopped outside, adrenaline rushing through our bodies. In the cold of the night, we rushed outside the tent with the flashlights, hoping to glimpse what grabbed our journalist forcibly. We couldn't find any sign of her at that point, as everything had quieted down once more. The crickets began to chirp in the distance, blocking out any sound she might have been trying to scream in the distance. Even our guide was nowhere to be found. For the hours that followed, we screamed their names and wandered off several meters from the tent before returning in fear. We had let panic get the best of us, and now we had two missing crew members, ourselves stranded literally in the middle of nowhere. As we returned to the tent, horrified as we were, we saw small splatters of blood on the grass as we shone our flashlights on it. Assuming that Yahim had wounded one of the abductors, we assumed that there would have been a blood trail, so I told the photographer to pack up and follow me along the trail. I guess we were both panicked then, because we decided not to. It was too risky and the tent had our rations. Getting lost was not an option, despite the theoretical blood trail that would lead us on back to where they came from. Hundreds of miles from civilization, with two missing people and a damaged tent, we were severely traumatized and fatigued. We didn't sleep until dawn. The terror of what lurked outside the tent forced us to stay inside it, holding the torn fabric together with our own hands. We felt like idiots realizing that we could have stayed inside the vehicles and spared ourselves the trouble of setting up the tent. We'd all still be here right now. That morning, a towing vehicle and small unit of armed rangers arrived. We had never been more grateful to anyone in our lives. They towed the vehicle and helped out folding the tent. The rangers were able to track the blood trail, only to find it disappear among a few small dead trees a few kilometers away from the main road. No sign of the journalist or our guide. The file he was carrying was found along the gravel road 15 meters away from the tent, which explains the metallic clatter of during the abduction. All in all, it was the most terrifying expedition I had ever been on. Few were able to get to Tristan da Cunha, passing through Africa and the Badlands, though I had never returned anywhere near that place ever again. The photographer I was with became one of the leading journalists at the magazine firm I used to intern at, courtesy of his article titled "The Ill-Fated Journey," while I settled down to manage a small camera shop in Minnesota. Our journalist and the guide were never found. Or at least, as much as I'd hate to imagine it, their bodies were recovered. Yahim's family invited me to the funeral, as they had accepted that he would never come back. As for our journalist, there was no funeral. Her relatives were definitely hopeful that she was still alive, as South African authorities are still on the lookout for her, even after all these years. A missing persons case that still remains open for anyone to solve. Post-expedition, January 10th, 1993. I won't forget it. Ever. Speculate as you may whether it was a coyote, a boar, a lion, or something else that ran amok in the wilderness of Africa, one thing stays in my mind. Whatever they were not something Africans would see every day. It was something you'd only see in that area, as far as I'm concerned, anyway. No other place in the world would have that quality, the atmosphere of the Badlands. They will forever haunt my memories.